I want our children to liberate their minds, from this receivership mentality, aid dependent mentality, that somebody else has to come to Africa to solve our problems. That's not what I see in Asia. I've spent over 20 years now in the development field. The last 20 years going to Asia. When I go to Asia, I don't see a depressed Asia. I don't see Asians waiting for somebody to come, give them aid to solve their problem. No way. I see Asians thinking competitiveness, technology transfer, trade, and they're ready to be creative to compete. We are not the only ones who had conflict. Cambodia had conflict. Vietnam had conflict. In fact, in the 60s and mid-70s, they were referring to Cambodia, Vietnam, Laos, and others as basket cases. They recovered. They transformed. And today, yes, they're self-sufficient in food production. They're major industrial hubs for producing goods and services, which are bought by OECD, rich OECD countries. What am I saying? None of us are destined to be poor. No nation is destined to have disease, disasters, and death only. It depends on the creativity and the determination of their people. And for us, the difference between us and many Asian countries is that God gave us everything. And you heard me talk about the Garden of Eden syndrome. And that is not from me. That's from Ali Mazrui back in 81. Because somehow, because God gave us everything, every season something grows, and the minerals are everywhere. My country, they just discovered one of the largest pieces of diamond ever in the world, 706 carats. They just discovered it last week. God gave us everything. So somehow it seems our creativity died. Somehow it seems we are not as aggressive and ambitious as we're supposed to be. I want our children, since we may have failed them with all these isms you mentioned, yeah? I want our children to believe that they can be a Bill Gates. I want them to believe that with all this God-given wealth, oil and gas, bauxite, iron ore, titanium, you name it, that in fact they can capture this 21st century. They're good as anybody. If I can leave poor Sierra Leone, that has been ranked at the bottom of the heap for almost 3 decades, we're amongst the 5 poorest. Back in 2008, we were the poorest of the poor, the lowest human development index. If I can defy that and go to such a level globally, it means any kid can do it. And I don't want anybody making our kids depressed, less creative. That's why I chose that topic. And Ghana, in particular, is a good choice, because you have led the way in many things. Your vision, in fact, of Kwame Nkrumah was 50 years before he's, you know, ahead of time. But Ghana is in a position today, with your newfound wealth of oil and gas and your strong agricultural base, to say, fine, we show the rest of Africa what it means to be successful.
That is very interesting. Frankly speaking, you've just mentioned oil. I was going to ask a different question, but I'll just touch it briefly and then we go back. In 2010, you were here. And that was the time that we started, you know, this whole prospecting for oil and getting oil. And listening to you yesterday, you said, whilst on your way back, you wrote an article. And you were virtually reflecting over this, you know, Dutch disease, whether oil could be a curse or indeed it is a curse. From 2010, today you are here. What reflections do you have?
Well, let me put it in context. I had the privilege then. Kofi Annan had invited me, Excellency Kofi Annan, Ted Turner, the billionaire founder of CNN, and I was here with Andrew Young, one of the civil rights liberators in America. And yes, we visited Takoradi, and I could see the oil rigs. But then we visited Elmina Palace, castle, that used to be almost the capital of slave trade. And what dawned on me as I was coming back on the plane, I started this article defying the Garden of Eden syndrome, which was published around the world a few months later. Two things struck me. I say, here I am in Elmina Castle, when Africans were exporting their young, between the age of 15 and 35, to the New World to give them energy to transform, to industrialize at that time. I say, now they discover oil and gas around the same location. You are in Elmina Castle, you can see the bay, right? I say, now we have oil and gas in Ghana. Will we do the same thing? Export oil and gas to light up the rest of the world and we remain in darkness? Yeah. Will we use oil and gas the same way we've done cocoa and coffee? You pick from the tree, Garden of Eden, you dry it and you export. You don't add value. I say now, can Ghana learn from other countries like Malaysia to say, fine, and both of you got independence at the same time. Now we have oil and gas. We immediately take a decision that we Ghanaians will begin to make plastics from our oil and gas. We immediately take the decision that we Ghanaians will now produce fertilizer to power our agriculture, because we are already one of the top agriculture producers of Africa, to make us even better agriculture producers, to use more fertilizer. And at the same time, with this new income, we diversify and drive industrialization for our children. You're over 20 million now. Yeah, that population, 26 million. I think by projections, you might be 35, 40 million in another 30 years, because we're having children like there is no tomorrow. You understand what I mean? That is what occurred to me. Can Ghana learn from the mistakes of Nigeria, but also learn from the successes of Malaysia? Yeah, to be able to transform now, to say, fine, God gave us oil and gas at the time that we are really now independent. There is no colonialism to blame. That we use this resource to propel our economy, and it is not unique. The Norwegians did it. The Malaysians, Petronas was a small player. Petronas, when they discovered gas in Malaysia, they didn't kill agriculture. They used the money to become number one in oil palm. And some of that germplasm they got from Ghana. Yeah? They used oil and gas to drive what they call agriculture-led industrialization. From there, they moved into other sectors to industrialize, to push again IT development. Can Ghana learn from a country where when they had independence around the same time, they have more than quadrupled their economy, but for most of the 3 decades of Ghana, from the 70s to about the late 90s, the economy was shrinking or performing less. Meanwhile, Malaysia was growing in bounds. So you learn from the mistakes of Nigeria, but you learn from the successes of Malaysia and others. That's what prompted.
Now you know we mandate.